Name the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Being here reminds me of when I was at university, back in the dark ages. I started doing a Bachelor of Arts degree, majoring in political science, philosophy, and sociology. So I say to people, I thank God that I came out Christian and sane, doing those combination of those subjects. I went on to study law afterwards. But I hate to sound philosophical about this, but it comes to my mind that we really need to figure out why we're here, why God created us. One thing I see in many students at your stage of life is a sense of hopelessness, a sense of a lack of direction, lack of vision, not really knowing what we stand for, what we want, and just getting on with life. Unfortunately, when you just get on with life, at best, you glide and you just are okay. At worst, you end up picking a very wrong road and you go very fast down it. And neither of those is a good scenario. A lot of that is not because people are bad people or they want to mess up their lives or don't want to mess up other people's lives. It's not because they just want to waste time. It's because we really don't know why we're here. We don't know why God created us, and we don't know what God calls us to. We are all called to something. There is no one here who is not called to something. And it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what kind of family you come from, what degree you've done, what degree you're doing. You all have at least one gift. More, usually, but at least one. And that one gift is going to be the secret of unlocking why you're here and what God is calling you to. Regardless of what that gift is, we're all called to one thing, all of us, and that is being the image and likeness of God, because that's how we were created, and being the light of God in the world. All of us are called. Now, some of us will be called differently. I was called to join the monastery and then later to become a bishop. Some of you will be called to different careers, different career paths in different countries. Some are called to be celibate, to become monks, nuns. Some are called to be married, to become priests. Some are called to be good family people, as parents. We're all called to different things. And there isn't one that is better than the other. And while I'm saying that, I'm also going to say that I am no different to you. My calling is just different. God has called me to something different. But the essence of my life and what I do is the same as yours, and that is being the image and likeness of God and being the light of God in the world. Now, we're all supposed to do that. We just do it differently. I do it by doing things like this, by spending time with you, by lots of other bits of ministry that I do. You do it in your own way. And sometimes that's going to be really grand and sort of big bang and flashing lights. And sometimes, most of the time, it's going to be very discreet. It's going to be things that are just day-to-day, where you witness to your family or your friends or your social group or anything like that. So realistically, to be the image and likeness of God, we're also called to be like Him. And one word that comes to mind, and it's a very fashionable word, is evangelism, to be an evangelist. And many of us think to be an evangelist means I've got to get on a plane, I've got to go to Central or South Africa, I've got to go to South America, I've got to go to some far exotic place to be an evangelist. And again, some people are called to that. Absolutely. But we are also called to be evangelists here, where we are. On a day like today, every day of our lives. And if we ask what the definition of an evangelist is, it's the bearer of good news, an announcer, one who announces, one who announces. So when you announce good news, when you bring good news, you're an evangelist. And that can be done very powerfully. And again, I want to reiterate one thing very importantly. That doesn't mean you need to hold the Bible in the middle of Trafalgar Square and chase people around with it. Because that's really scary. No one likes to have religion, faith, Christianity rammed down their throats. Actually, when you do that, you end up pushing people away. There's this terminology of someone being a Bible basher. It's just really hitting the point home, trying to force religion, force ideology, force faith. And people can't be engaged with that way. What we must do, though, is bring good news, to be bearers of good news. And that's a great privilege. It's a great privilege because God himself, in this sense of the word, is an evangelist. Because he brought us good news. He brought good news to Adam when he created Eve for him. He brought good news to humanity when he said to Noah that never again would he bring that devastation to the world. He brought good news to the Israelites through Moses when he promised them that they would be led into the land that was prepared for them. And from that point, he brings us good news because he promised us salvation. We were created, we fell, but he didn't leave us. He didn't abandon us. So that good news is essential. It's beautiful. And so he is a bearer of good news. And so an evangelist, if we're going to speak in that context, is one who proclaims. Don't sit idly by and just wait for things to happen. Don't sit idly by and just expect that things are going to fall on you. To proclaim means you need to be active. And often proactive. We are often reactive. So if something happens, we'll do something. And that's why I was so encouraged and inspired by this group. Michael, from the minute he came up to university, because, you know, we'd seen the youth ministry down there and then seeing it up here, really fired up about doing something in university. And you guys with him. And that's really good. Because you actually did something proactively. You did something and you wanted to start something. No one told you to do it. No one asked you to do it. But you felt it had to be done. For yourselves, as a community, and as a group of wonderful young people, but also have people around you, bringing people around you in as well. There's a problem though. With the problem is that with evangelism and the way it's played out at the moment, it's become quite fashionable, and it gives you a buzz. You know, everyone wants to be an evangelist. Everyone wants to go and preach the gospel. Everyone wants to go and serve the poor. Everyone. But it's not just a privilege. Of course it's a privilege. It's a privilege to spread the word of God. It's a privilege to be a proclaimer. It's a privilege to carry that news. Imagine, just at a much lower level, if you were sitting here and someone walked in with a letter from the Queen, right? Someone who is entrusted to carry this letter personalized to you and give it to you. You think, wow, this person must be really trusted. This person must be really there, influential. You've all been given the same thing. You've all been given a personalized letter to the world and said to the different, we've received the scriptures, and the scriptures are an important message to the whole of humanity. And it is a privilege for us to do that. So don't ever underestimate it. Don't ever think, well, yeah, you know, if I feel like it. No, it's an honor. When St. Paul speaks about us being fellow workers with God, that is an incredible privilege. First of all, fellow workers means you're almost you're at the same level. So of course, God is not going to be human, so he is raising us to a level of spirituality in which he says, I want you to help me. I'm going to come down as far as I can to your level, but I'm also going to have to raise you up a little bit as well, so you can be with me. And so this work of evangelism, this work of spreading the good news, giving the good news, is actually a beautiful thing in which God comes to us and says, I have a really important message. This message has to go out to everyone, and I want you to help me distribute it. I want you to be a vehicle for the delivery of that word. But with a privilege, with any privilege comes what? Responsibility. With any privilege comes responsibility. And therefore, we must be responsible. Mark 16, 15 and 16. Our Lord says, go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe will be condemned. We usually stop at the first bit. We usually, you know, talk about this is the Great Commission. Go into the whole world, preach the gospel to every creature. Great. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. And so we think, wow, I've got to go out there, I've got to preach. I've got to say these words, I've got to distribute them. I've got to give them. But there is a very dangerous conclusion to that same passage. We stop at he who believes and is baptized will be saved. But then, it actually goes on to, he who does not believe will be condemned. Why has that person not believed? Is it because my message wasn't good enough? Is it because I didn't take it seriously enough? Is it because I wasn't faithful enough? Which one of those? Maybe it's a combination. Now, if you've done everything you can, and the person rejects the message, that's their prerogative. God has given us freedom, and he expects us to use that freedom. His own disciples, those who were closest to him, rejected him at times, doubted him at times. One of them betrayed him. So he leaves us that option. But if we have done everything possible, that's fine. But if I haven't, then maybe I am responsible for that person not believing. And that can be statically and dynamically. So I could statically be responsible because I haven't done the thing. And because I haven't done the thing, or I haven't done enough, or I haven't been there for long enough, then this person is not believing. But dynamically, it could be because I'm either giving the wrong message, or giving a message that leads people down the wrong path. And that is absolute condemnation for us. When God gives us something beautiful to share, we must share it, unaltered. And that's why, for us as an Orthodox church, those of you who are interested in Orthodoxy, if you listen to Premier Radio, there's actually a program tomorrow at 2:30 in the afternoon, a 1-hour program on Orthodoxy, that I recorded earlier this week with two other panelists, one an evangelical scholar and the other an Eastern Orthodox scholar. When we talk about Orthodoxy, we talk about this pure faith that we've taken, not just from St. Mark. St. Mark was the starting point, that before St. Mark, there was our Lord himself, who commissioned the apostles, who commissioned the disciples, who commissioned St. Mark, who then ordained. And I can trace my ordination, my personal ordination, as a priest, back to not only Pope Shenouda, who consecrated and ordained me, but from him all the way back to St. Athanasius and St. Mark himself, and from him back to our Lord. See, that is this beauty of what we call apostolic succession. It's that connection from the very beginning, from the origin, all the way today, and it continues to the end. And it's not just that, it's our teaching as well. I'm not here to tell you that we're better than everyone else, because why not? We've been given a privilege. We've been given an incredible privilege. But we've also been given a responsibility to be gracious and humble about it. So yes, we've been given a treasure. We don't flaunt it to make people feel like they don't have a treasure, but we share it. We proclaim it as a beautiful thing. And we have. We've been very fortunate. We've been very blessed to receive teachings, our sacraments. This morning I prayed one of the most beautiful liturgies I've ever prayed. Many of you will know that His Eminence Metropolitan Bachonius is here being treated in London. And he's still not fully well, he's still recovering, but we prayed a very, very small liturgy in his hospital with him this morning. There's only a handful of us. He was in his wheelchair, we were there. We had an altar board that we use. You've all used them in your conferences when you go and do liturgy different places. Very small altar utensils. The urbana that was about this big. And it was just a beautiful liturgy. But it's that sacramental beauty that we have that has also lasted these 2,000 years. Since our Lord said, take, eat, take, drink, do this. So we have a responsibility to share that. And we have a lot to share. Don't forget, though, that when we share, no one wants you to share really bad stuff. People want you to share nice stuff, encouraging things. Of course, we tell people that there is judgment and condemnation. That becomes part of it, but that's not the starting point. When we are supposed to proclaim the good news, the encouragement, the beauty, then we give it with love. And we can't do it if we don't feel. We become very hollow. Difference between that and that. See, that's solid. You can see it. It doesn't just clang. It doesn't make a big noise for no reason. This one does, because it's nothing there. So with us, we can't just be hollow. We have to be full. What are we full of? We're full of God's grace. Because He gives it to us without us even deserving it. Grace is an undeserved gift. And it's a gift that we've been given. He gives us salvation. How many of us know, or, and I'm really sorry to say this, even care that we've been given salvation? I'm not saying we're all suddenly saved. We have the potential to be saved. Because through the cross and the resurrection, all the obstacles have been removed. And it's up to us now to take that entitlement and work with it and make sure that we get to the place where God wants us to be. But we've got to share those things from a fullness. From a fullness. When we're filled, and we keep being filled, we overflow. When we overflow, we fill those around us. And they overflow, and they fill those around them. But if we become empty, we have nothing to give. We'll keep trying, and we'll become even more empty. And the more empty we become, the more frustrated and angry and tired and worn out we become. And we start to become resentful. How many servants have you seen in your churches become bitter about serving after a while? It's natural. It happens everywhere. And it's because they don't look after their own well-being. They're so dedicated and focused on giving to others that they forget that they have to receive as well. So as an evangelist, as a proclaimer of the good news, we have to be filled too. You're not just filled. You have to want to be filled. You have to take steps to be filled. When I was coming up here, my car didn't just suddenly miraculously develop a full tank of petrol. I had to stop and fill it up. So likewise, we don't just miraculously become filled. We have to stop. We have to focus. We have to spend time with God. We have to take from Him. I'm sure that if I said to you, okay, let's ask a question. What is it that you need to do to have a good spiritual life? I would get the same two stock standard answers that you've been giving since you were 5 in Sunday school. Pray and read the Bible. But that's how we say them. We say pray and read the Bible. Do we really believe them? Do we do anything with them? Do we actually pick up our Bibles and read them? Do we want to get anything out of them? Or is it just either, yeah, I'll do it tomorrow, or yes, I actually pick it up, but it's just a box I tick. Okay, picked up my Bible, I've read my chapter, done. That's not an evangelist. That's bare minimum. And you know what? If we do it that way, we're not really being filled. What are we going to give? What are we going to give of ourselves if we don't have anything? Our Lord said something very important we have to remember. John 18:36, He said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from here." So we fight for something totally different. We don't fight to hold on to the world. We don't fight to be filled by the world. We fight to hold on to what is heavenly and be filled by what is heavenly. It just happens that we're also in the world. I mean, let's face it, you're here, you're doing degrees, you've got careers, you're working, you're responsible, and you have to. Because as faithful stewards, you've been given these talents. And you need to use them effectively. So you have to be a good steward. Just like you have to be a good child, a good sibling, later on a good parent. You have to be good at your career. You have to be good in whatever you do. You have to be faithful and filled. But don't be filled by this world, because it's not satisfying. You'll keep trying to be filled, and you'll keep looking for things, but it won't help you. We've all done it, right? We've all tried to fill ourselves on physical, human, worldly, tangible things. And it's never enough. It's never enough. It's the kind of food you eat, or the clothes you wear, or the car you drive, or the house you live in, or the company you keep, or all of this stuff. Yes, you have to wear clothes, and you have to live in the house, and you have to drive a car sometimes, and you have to have money, and you have to live. You have to do these things. You have to do them. But they shouldn't be what we try to do to fill ourselves. What we fill ourselves on is God's grace. What we fill ourselves on is every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. That's what our Lord said when He was tempted in the desert, in the wilderness. And Satan said to Him, "You know what? Aren't you hungry?" "Yes, I'm hungry. Of course I'm hungry. But that's not what's going to fill me. I'll eat. There will come a time where I will eat. There will come a time when I will eat bread. This is not the time for bread. This is the time when I fast and I pray and I prepare myself for my ministry and I fill myself, and of course it's an example to us, because he is God. An example to us where he says, this is the time where I fill myself on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. That is my food. When our Lord was at the well with the Samaritan woman, and his disciples came to the Gospel of St. Luke and said, Rabbi, eat. He said, I have food that is not, you don't know about. I've got other work. And they said, is someone going to have to eat your food? You know, the disciples were lovely men. But they didn't always get what our Lord was saying. And that should make us feel very good. Because sometimes we think, oh, I don't understand this. They didn't understand the word either. Just remember that. It's complex. We understand that more now because we have context, because we've been taught, because we understand what it is all about. But actually, when you look at back then, when our Lord said, I have food to eat that is not of this world, and someone brought him food? No. That's not my food. My food is to do the will of him who sent me. That's what nourishes me. So nourishment for me is the word of God and fulfilling the word of God. Not just reading it, but reading it, absorbing it, and fulfilling it in our lives. Remember the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 10, starting from verse 38. Now it happened as they went, and he entered a certain village, a certain woman named Martha welcomed him to her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his words. This is our Lord coming into Martha and Mary's house. And obviously wherever our Lord went, it was like an Egyptian azuma. Everyone turns up. I saw your right hand, thought I'd drop in. Everyone, if you imagine, they heard about this incredible, what they thought was a prophet, this great man, this teacher, the one who performs miracles. Let's face it, we all either want to learn or want something or have someone who needs healing or we need healing. Everyone wanted something from him. And so when he turned it up and went into that village, they all came in. So Martha welcomed him into their home. Mary sat at his feet. And we read in verse 40, but Martha was distracted with much serving. Martha was distracted with much serving. What we have to realize here, it's not that the serving that was a problem. Because God wants us to serve each other. Of course, God would want her to serve people at home. It's not the serving that was the problem, it was the distracted by the serving. And that's one very important warning I want to give you. If you want to be that person who is going to go out and be a good Christian, whether it's very overtly by standing on the street corner and preaching, which you're welcome to do if you like, or if it's just through your own personal witness and personal life on a daily basis, don't be distracted by the function of serving and forget to sit at the feet of Christ and learn from him. You see, Martha alone, in her distraction, was one extreme. Mary alone, sitting at our Lord's feet, was another extreme. What we need to do is be a combination of Mary and Martha. To know when it is right to sit at his feet and learn and absorb. And then once we've absorbed, when it is right for us to stand up and to share that. Because that's essential. And she approached him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore tell her to help me. Wow, threw her under the bus, really. Went up and said, come on, You've come here, you've brought all these people have come to see you. Now I'm left serving this brat of a sister of mine. Lovely girl that she is, have blessed me to serve. I bet you've never heard her refer to as that before. I'm going to get in so much trouble. But hopefully if I make it to the kingdom, I'll meet Mary and she'll say, really, I'm a brat? Anyway. Didn't mean it. So, turns around and says, she's left me. Tell her. And our Lord said to her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things. You see, when we distract ourselves with service, we become worried and troubled. When we distract ourselves with the function and the mechanism of doing things, we become worried and troubled. We are not supposed to be worried and troubled when we serve. Because at the end of the day, it's not my service or yours. I remember years ago, probably about 12, 13 years ago, looking at the scale of youth ministry and thinking, what am I doing? I mean, I don't know how to reach all these people. I don't know how to provide for all these people. You have people who want every kind of ministry. People want real depth, and people want real charisma, and people who want very quiet things, and people who want dynamic things, people want small groups, people want large groups. You know, you've heard it all. You do one thing and you say, no, we want this one. You do the other thing and say, no, we want this one. And you're trying to sort of provide. And I became very overwhelmed and thought, what happens if one of these people isn't saved? Is it really my fault? I mean, what can I do? Can I really ensure the salvation of everyone? And I actually went and spoke to one of the more senior bishops who I really respect. I respect his opinion. And I said, listen, I've been having these thoughts. And he sat me down and he said, I understand what you're saying because we all go through that feeling. Because of a sense of responsibility. Like I said, it's a privilege, but a responsibility. So it's a sense of responsibility. But what you have to understand is you cannot ensure or guarantee the salvation of people. All you can do is work your best at your own salvation and then serve them from that perspective. What we do sometimes when we try to share in this work of evangelism and outreach is we focus so much on others that we forget ourselves. And when we focus on others, we give everything we have. We give every ounce of energy and being we have. And then we turn up being quite empty. We end up being quite empty. This may seem like it doesn't really have a relevance in your life at this stage of your life. But I assure you it does. I know it sounds like a big title, but I'm not talking about you going and dedicating your life today to preaching in the Amazon. What I am saying is when you walk your daily walk and you live your daily life and you meet the people you meet daily, whether it be in your homes, if you're still living at home, which is the issue we're having here, whether it be in your homes, or people in your universities, or people on the street whom you may never ever know. You have a responsibility that one word you say to one of these people will make a difference. I had one experience in London. I had a meeting, and at that meeting, it was a House of Parliament, and a young lady there who was working as a tour guide said, are you Orthodox? And I said, yes, and I explained it. And she said, well, can I speak to you? I said, fine, we sat and we spoke. And she said, well, I really feel like I need something. What do you suggest? And I said, well, why don't you come? We have an all-English service you might like to attend. why don't you come and attend? And she did, once, twice. She came and she found something she'd been lacking. Now, I didn't mean to say anything to anyone that day. I was going around doing what I was doing on that day. It wasn't pastoral at all. But God decided to use me. And it's a blessing for me. Just as God will decide to use you as well. And it'll be something that you won't even notice. But there's one very important caveat here, and that is, within this life that you live, within this particular, this concept of fellowship, because this is a fellowship book. The reason you have a fellowship group is to provide support for them. When I was meeting with your brothers and sisters in London yesterday, I said to them, when we set up Focus now 13 years ago, set up Focus. Some of you will know, so the first people we had at Focus from the Universal Connections to London would have been Joe Salema, Bishoy Gindi, and Mark Kessler. They were the three guys who were studying in Kingston University at the time. We had no students anywhere else because everyone was too young. And we started in Joe's house doing a Bible study there and setting up our first Focus group. And the idea is this, that the Word of God is not limited to church or even your room or your home. The Word of God must go out to people. And the reason we have Focus and the reason we're doing this ministry is it is a way of taking the church to the people where they are. So it's bringing the church into your environment here. Because some of us hang up our coats of Christianity at the gate of the universities we're walking in. We live very different lives in here. And then walk out and put that coat back on and live our lives. And that's why we like to keep our lives very separate. You know, I'm sure you'd agree with this. You like to keep your university groups in sort of one silo, and your social groups in another silo, and your church groups in another silo, and your family. And you don't want any mixing between them. Because mixing between them could be disastrous. Imagine if your parents knew what you got up to with your university friends. Or your university friends knew what you got up to with your church friends. That looks really weird. What? Conferences? Retreats? Fellowship groups? Are you some sort of Christian nut? What are you doing? Or the other way. And we like to keep things very safely and cleanly sectioned, because we don't like that mix. But at the end of the day, in my terminology, that creates what I call Christian multiple personality disorder. You become different people. You know, you will speak and dress differently in one situation, to another, to a third, to a fourth. And one day it catches, believe me, one day it catches up with you. And it becomes very confusing. We're not supposed to be different people. When you are giving your presentation as the image of God, you are one image of God, image and likeness of God. You are one face of Christ. In whatever you do. I'm going to use chalk. I haven't seen chalk in years. So, what happens is this. When we talk about our spiritual lives, right? We say, okay, you have church, home, uni, social. Can you see why I don't use words? Because you would never be able to know what I was writing. I sometimes take notes and then forget what I've written. I can't read my own notes. Which becomes very embarrassing. And then, career. And then, you think, okay, hang on, I forgot something. my spiritual life. Right? And so what I do is I play this balancing act where this one goes up, this one goes down, this one goes down, this one goes up, and so on and so forth. And usually what happens when we run out of time is this one goes like that, and like that, and like that, and like that, and then there. Because it's just a different silo, because it's just a different segment. Whereas actually, it should be something different. It should be this. So God doesn't just exist in this. God exists there. So basically, you have a godly foundation to your church life, to your home life, to your life, to your social life, to your career. So that no matter how these go up and down, they're built on this very, very firm foundation. And that's what gives you strength. So rather than having different colors, you know, red, green, blue, all of this, what you do in your spirituality is you have a drop of that spiritual life in everything. So all of these are tinged with the same color of godliness. So you become a godly man or woman in your home, a godly man or woman in your university, in your social life, with your friends, everywhere. And that is the way to become a true evangelist. That's the way to actually have purpose. And you need to help each other with this. You need to support each other. You can't just let each other go down paths that don't matter. Call each other to account, but also be gracious enough when you are called to account to be humble and say, thank you for telling me. So bringing this fellowship group here is about bringing the church to you, and it's about something else that's very important. It is about sanctifying this place. Where you are, that place is sanctified through you. Your universities should not be a place that brings fear into your hearts, or the hearts of your parents, or the hearts of your confession fathers, because they are places where your life can go wrong. University is a place that becomes sanctified by you, by your presence in it. So we shouldn't be worried that you are going to be affected by it, but that you should affect it. And it sounds like a tall order. I'm not saying to you convert the whole university. What I'm saying to you is have an effect on every person you meet. Have a good effect. Have a powerful effect. And you all know the words of Francis of Assisi, who said, preach the word, and if need be, speak. So it's that preaching that is essential. But a preaching that doesn't necessarily mean, sometimes it will, not always, necessarily mean I stand up and speak, but it means I preach with my life. So we are all called to this union. We're all called the image and likeness of God, because that's how we were created. We're all called to sanctification. We're all called as fellow workers. And God will not call you beyond your ability. And He will not give you a responsibility beyond what you are able to do. And He will not put you before an obstacle that you cannot overcome.